that thought that I had, like I had this one like profound, you know, thought of like when I realized that I wasn't in my body anymore and I'm looking at my body and I had no emotional attachment to it in any way, shape or form.
I'd like to welcome to the show, Anna Stone. How are you doing, Anna?
I'm good. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you so much for coming on the show, my dear. I appreciate you coming on and sharing your unique story, unique life journey that you've gone through. The path that you are walking is interesting, to say the least. So before we get into your near-death experience, what was your life like prior to the near-death experience?
Well, I was a research scientist for about 20 years on different contracts for Department of Defense, DARPA, UCLA, VA hospital, like all working in conjunction together, right? And I was in a neural engineering lab. And so I worked with brain tissues. And it was pretty boring, to be honest, pretty boring. Despite the fancy, you know, contracts, we didn't know what we were doing, like anytime, you know, until later, because it's all piecemealed out. So I was a scientist, and I thought in very scientific black and white terms of how things are and how they aren't, but by what we can prove, you know, with scientific testing and instrumentation. So that was that. Like, everything was black and white in my world up until that point.
Were you religious at all?
Oh, no. I grew up in a very, very religious, like Baptist home. And yeah, we couldn't, like, it was really super strict. At around age 8, I had seen something that I didn't sit well with me, how my family was reacting compared to what they were saying in church, like didn't jive.
Wow.
And so I made a comment about it, and ew, that was the start of my black sheep status going forward. And it's okay with me, but no, absolutely not. It was preposterous to me to, you know, the whole religious thing was nonsense as far as I was concerned.
Didn't make any sense to you whatsoever. Nope. It's interesting. It is interesting what some people will say at church, but how they'll actually act is a completely
right.
Different thing.
That's exactly what I saw it. And I was like 8 and I called it out and I got you in trouble, big trouble for that.
So tell me what were the events leading up to your death?
Okay. Well, like I had been doing the science thing, right? But then I had a period of kind of my life falling apart and was just a total loser. Like at this point in my life, it's like the worst iteration of me possible. And I'm so glad it's not that way anymore. I was drinking all the time. Like I just completely lost my way and was a total, just a loser. Like I just had no motivation, nothing. I had a new kid. Like my daughter was like almost two at the time. And I was just being a like totally waste of space. And I was feeling a little sick. I didn't feel so great. I was getting like dizzy and stuff. And you know, I thought I was having my cycle like for a really long time. And I was like, God, and I came out the day that this happened. I was like, I think I'm bleeding to death, guys. And I was joking about it, but not. And the next thing that I know, I'm in the hospital. Like, so I guess I fainted right then, I guess. You know, and that's when I found out that I had, I woke up in the hospital and I had a blood transfusion thing happening, which was just, oh my God, like terrifying to me because the idea of that was just really gross and to me, like someone else's blood in my body. And it didn't dawn on me quite what was happening, you know, other than that. And then I was told I had this ectopic pregnancy that had ruptured and caused internal bleeding. And I had lost like half of my blood and they had to do this transfusion. And I was like, oh, okay. And I thought to myself, like, I'm fine. But then as soon as I thought that, it was like my body felt like I felt myself dying, like 100%. Like I know for a fact that this feeling that came over me was death. And like how it felt was so unmistakable and panic inducing, kind of, you know, something was very wrong, you know, like very, very wrong. And I knew it. And then it was so intense. I felt like I was going to literally explode. Like I felt like there was so much tension building up from the inside out, like inside of me. Like I felt like I was going to pop. But like it got to this point where it was like too much. And I did pop, but like only out of my body. And then I was out, I'm looking at myself laying in the bed, and like, you know, I watched the next few minutes of them, you know, me coding and them trying to resuscitate me and stuff. Like,
I just, what's going through your head? What's going through your head at this point?
Well, immediately I knew what happened. Like, it was weird. It was like, immediately I was like, oh shit. And that's actually that thought that I had. Like, I had this one like profound, you know, thought of like when I realized that I wasn't in my body anymore and I'm looking at my body, and I had no emotional attachment to it in any way, shape, or form. It was just a factual thing. Like, shit, that sucks. That was it. That's like the only thing I said. And then at that point I was like, oh crap, I'm still me. Like, my attitude's still here. My sarcasm is still here. Like, huh. You know, like, interesting. pretty much like that. Like, it was just like, that's too bad. You know, like, I could have made it longer, you know, but I guess not. Like, no big deal. It was just very devoid of emotion, very detached from the human that, you know, the human feelings and emotions that were, you know, used to. I didn't have those.
So it was it was very much like you, like, oh, I lost a pair of clothes. Oh, shoot.
Yeah. Like, darn it. Yeah, it was not a big deal. Like, and it wasn't a big deal. That was, I guess, I realized it wasn't a big deal. But then I had this brief second of my kids, right? You know, and that instantaneous, like, as soon as I said my kids, I was immediately 210 miles away, where my daughter Ashley, my oldest one, was in college taking a test, and I was in her classroom. I could see what she was wearing, you know, her stressing out over there on her test, the time it was on the wall of the clock, you know, behind her. And I was like, should be cool. And then Lucy, like, and then I was immediately back at the hospital, looking at my little one who's in the waiting room playing Legos, whatever. And I was like, should be fine. And then I went back into the where I was with my body for a minute and just watched them stop working on me and give up on resuscitating me. And one of the guys, the younger technician or whatever he was, he said, we're going to stop now. Like, she's, you know, she's only 30, whatever, you know, like, I don't know if he said my age, but he said, she's like only in her 30s or something. And the doctor had made this offhanded comment about, what do you expect? She's a former junkie. And, I was not a former junkie. That's not true. So I was like, but so that would make me mad, right? Like, that normally would upset me that someone said that. I wasn't upset at all. I was just like, is that necessary? Like, that was the thought that went through my head. Was that necessary? But it wasn't upset, and it wasn't even like angry. It was just facts. And yeah, so like that plays in later, like when I came back, like, because I asked him about it.
Sorry. So what happened next? You're outside of your body. Yeah. You're looking down. They've stopped.
Mm-hmm. So I'm there. I'm like looking at my body, and I'm like, so if I was like standing to the right side of me, like in the room, and so I'm looking to my right and I'm in the room, but then I noticed that if I looked over to the left, I wasn't in the hospital anymore. I was somewhere else, like looking one way, it took me somewhere else. Like, it just was in this other place, and it was like a waiting, it was, I don't want to say a waiting room, because that's the best I can do though, with the language that I have, is it was like a room, and I knew it was somewhere I was supposed to be waiting for something to happen. There was no people. I didn't see any tunnel. There was no ghosts or spirits of dead relatives. I was just in this room. It was like lit up from some unseen light, you know, source. And it was just like a waiting room, like no chairs or anything. So it was just a space, you know, like a blank space. And so I went there, and I didn't see anybody for a while, but I could feel stuff around me. Like, there was a lot of things going on, but I couldn't see any of it. I could feel it though. And it was like, I was very aware that people, energy, souls, whatever, were all linked up together, like sharing data, like uploading their, like, I feel like if I had stayed, you know, if I was staying, I would be linked up and like uploaded all my memories or something for that collective kind of, that's kind of what it felt like. I couldn't, and I was, and at this point I realized I don't have a body. Like,
Right.
so it didn't dawn on me, even though I'm looking at my body like for a while in the bed, it didn't dawn on me that like, hey, that was the body. So you don't have it now. You're just this form of ish. And it was huge. Like, we are huge. We're very big, taking up tons of space, like so much space. And there is like an outline ish to you, right? There's an edge of your consciousness, but it's not definable really by anything other than, oh, I have no idea. Actually, I can't even, but you're just like, it was like little pinpoints of light, I guess. Like, it was weird. And I realized, wait, how am I seeing? Like, I'm seeing 360 degrees, so I can see behind me. And I'm like, oh, right, because I don't have a head, because there's no bones in my head to block. Wait, there's no bone. I don't have a head. I have no eyes. So how the hell am I seeing? Like, so I was kind of a little bit perturbed. I'm not perturbed, but just like, interesting. I guess I'll figure it out. But like, it was weird. And then all of a sudden, there was a person standing in front of me that, you know, came out of literally nowhere. And it was a woman, and it was literally me. Just another iteration of me standing in front of me. Looked a little different though. Like, her face was a little different, had worn different lines, like different expression lines and things like that. Like, we'd had different experiences, clearly. but it was me. And I just, like, I guess I knew what was going on. Because I didn't even question it. I just was like, oh. And then I heard that word, nope. That's it. Like, I heard nope. And like that, I just knew what that meant. It meant, nope, you're going back. You know what's going on. And like, and I looked back at my body and I was like, how am I going to fit in there? Right? Like, how the hell am I going to fit? I'm so huge. And then I went into the belly button. I got shoved like back through my navel. Why? I don't know. Like, that's so weird to me. And that's when I saw a tunnel. Like, coming back in was when I saw a tunnel, and that hurt so much. It was very painful on the way back in. And that's what shot me up and brought me back. I was still hooked up to the machine, right? Like, they hadn't taken off the leads. Everyone's back was turned to me. Like, they were all filling out paperwork and stuff. And I just shot up. So there was no like warning beeps to let them know like I was coming back. as you know, and I came back and scared the absolute crap out of at least that one guy.
I was about to say that must have been terrifying only for you, but for everybody in the room.
Well, right. Like, I felt like how I felt was like if someone had held my, like, literally it felt like if that somebody had my head underwater and was holding me underwater, and until the second I couldn't like take it, and I was gonna, you know, drown, like inhale water. Like, I could not breathe because for 6 minutes I had no oxygen. So I was coming out of that and taking that first breath to like recuperate the oxygen I was deprived of for like 6 minutes. So it was loud and shocking, and it was very disorienting for me. And then the jumping around in the room and loud audible gasps were also stressful as well. And then I looked at the doctor and I was like, as soon as I could catch my breath, I said, did you say, you know, hey, like, she is former junkie? And he wouldn't answer me. He just looked at me like, you know, I'm like, did you say that? Like, did you say that about me? Like, and I think, I'm pretty sure he thought I was trying to like get him in trouble, you know, but that wasn't my goal. I needed to know, did I actually hear that? Because upon coming back, it was very clear, like, oh my God, I just died. Like, I knew what happened. Like, and mm-hmm. this can't be real because I don't believe in this at all. And so he can't have said that. Like, this can't be right. So I'm going to ask him, and then he's going to tell me, no, right? I didn't say that. That's just your neurons misfiring or whatever. But nope, he apologized, and he still thought I was trying to get him in trouble. He didn't realize he didn't get what I was trying to do, like, at all. Mm-hmm. He was trying to cover his ass, but I was like, I don't care. I just need to know if you said it. Did I hear that? Like, did I hear it? And he's like, there's no way you could have heard that. Like, you were clinically dead. I'm like, so you said it.
So you did it, right? I'm going to get you in trouble. Just say it.
You know, no. He's like, I'm very sorry. And I was like, I don't care. Like, you know, because I didn't care. But that was bad. I didn't want that news. I didn't
So,
want that.
what's interesting is this was fascinating about your story because you're basically walking in as an atheist, essentially, right?
Right. I mean, I believed in maybe something, but I didn't know what the heck it was. Yeah.
Agnostic at
Right.
best. So you come in, you don't have any real belief of anything. You go to the other side. Your personality is the person who you were is still there, but it's devoid of emotion that we feel here. You are uploaded to a mainframe almost. You can start feeling everyone's thoughts and feelings, almost like you just like were connected, like in the Matrix in the back,
right.
and you're connected to something else, and all this other information is there. And then you get swung back in, you feel all the pain in your body the moment you just slammed back in. And then the emotions come back. And then the logic comes back that you had in your head before. So that logic, those beliefs didn't exist in the other side because it just, there was a knowing on the other side.
Right. Right. Yeah. There is, so like people ask me that a lot. Like, did you, you know, do you, cause there's that myth or rumor, you know, that you, when you die, you get down, like know everything about everything. Right. You know, people say that. That's not what I experienced, but I do know I did experience enough to understand, I think, what it is. It's like, you don't know what you don't know. Right. So, you have to, anything that I thought about during that brief time of 6 minutes, right? Like, I was able to get the answer to. If I thought about it consciously, like, and was like, what about this? It came, but it wasn't like all of it just came at once. You know what I mean? Like, I had to ask for it. Right. So it's like, you have to know what you want to know it.
Yeah. From other near-death experiences, they'll like ask a question and all of a sudden they'll like, oh, so that's how quantum physics works.
Right. Yeah. 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 Like, I mean, it was like, because I asked, like, and that's why it's hard to describe it, because I didn't ask out loud. Like, I just thought it in my head. And then I got answer about like, what does nope mean? You know, like, I'm going back. Like, I knew that. Like, it was like an instantaneous, not even an answer. It was just like a knowing. It's really hard to describe.
Yeah. It all sounds similar to a forms of things I've heard before. It's really interesting. So when you come back, you obviously are essentially trying to verify that you were dead. So you have a kind of a verified near death experience because you could start telling people things that are happening in the room and everyone's like, what the hell's going on? Okay. So you're back in your body. You're dealing with this. How do you psychologically process this from not only hours after, days, weeks, months, and even maybe years after that experience?
Well, like it's been a lot. I'm not gonna lie. Like, it's been a lot. It changed my entire life. Like, everything about it. My entire life is different now. Like, I stopped, like, for instance, like, I can't drink alcohol anymore. So I literally came back sober. Like, that 6 minutes cleared me of a drinking problem. I tried and I couldn't, my body physically wouldn't take it. Like, and I just was like, fine, forget it. Now, I tried that before and it didn't work out, you know? So this was weird. And the doctors couldn't tell me why. They're like, just take it as a blessing is what I told. And I'm like, fine. But at home, when they let me go the same day, like literally maybe a couple hours later, you know? And so, because the insurance,
of course, insurance.
Right. And, you know, I was like, I was in tears. Like, and I was married at the time though, to an atheist. And he just kept telling me I was imagining it. Like, he kept telling me that it wasn't real. And like, I'm over here, the person that would say that too, normally, right? You know? So like, he knew that. And it was frustrating because I was like, you've got to understand, if I'm saying this right now, like, it's serious. Like, this is not a joke. Like, I saw some stuff. Like, I can't, how do you explain this? And he was arguing with me about it, like telling me I was just losing my mind. You know, like, I know, I guess maybe at the time he was trying to help, but it was not the right way at all. And then like, I just, like, at one point I remember laying on the couch and just thinking, holy shit, like, girl, your life is like, what the hell? You have a new kid. Like, what are you doing with yourself? Like, you just died. Like, it was really hard on me. Like, cause it was like all the stuff I've been avoiding, you know, like all that hit me. Like, I've got to take care of stuff. I can't do this anymore. Like, I've got to get my life together. And then it was like, oh my God, I died. Like, what? And I saw things like, my person, I existed past this. Like, I don't know what happens after 6 minutes. I can only say for 6 minutes what happens, right? Like, I don't know. Maybe it all goes nothing. It goes away. I can't tell you. But those 6 minutes were like not, it was not cool. Like, I was really upset about it because, and I still have a hard time with it actually, because it's still like, it racks my brain. Like, how, it's just a lot. It's a lot. If I went 38, 36, almost 4 decades of my life thinking one way, and to have that all shifted in 6 minutes is a lot to take in.
Right. That's why I was asking. And I ask a lot. I ask that same question to all my near-death experience guests, because I can only imagine if your foundation of your entire existence is based on this thought. And this goes for religion, non-religion, God, Buddha, whoever you believe in. And someone all of a sudden says, everything that you've known is now false. I'm sorry. This is another idea. And then it destroys the foundation of your existence, essentially, of what you've based on, because it's a chain reaction of, if I don't believe this, then they lied to me here, or I made a mistake here, and then ego gets involved and it just starts to crumble your entire identity. Right. And that's what someone's saying something, are you reading something, are you hearing something? You experience something that is so much more vivid than reading a book or having someone tell you something. And then you having to process that, and you're still processing it.
Yeah, I am. I mean, I am in therapy, like actively, like I'm getting my master's and doctorate, like second master's and doctorate in psychology and consciousness studies right now. Like, I'm in therapy too, because I know that I need to, you know, this is stuff that I process still, like there's, because stuff keeps coming up. That's the weird thing about it, is like,
what do you mean exactly?
Like, I got that, like that word that I was given, that note, whatever, it was like almost like a file, like a zip drive or something, because it keeps, like, things keep popping up in my mind now that, like, just out of nowhere, I'll just know something or have some like revelation about something. Like, when you want, say, some physics, you know?
So in other words, there was, okay, this is interesting. So you were, come on, someone downloaded a file into your head, essentially, and you've slowly, it gets revealed at, inopportune times throughout your life, in the shower, in dinner, or something like that.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden you're like, what? I don't, how do I know how to paint now? I mean, not that, but you know, something like that.
Right. Because I was really mad at myself that I wasn't more upset about my children. Right. Because I was effectively orphaning both of my kids. My oldest daughter's father had passed away from cancer. So she was, that I was all she had. And I mean, if she's an adult now, but like still, she'd still be, you know, like without parents, both of them. And my Lucy was only like just going to be two, like, you know, and I wasn't even upset about the fact that I was leaving them and, you know, like not going to, like I was dead. Didn't bother me. And I was really mad at myself. So I was like, what kind of parent are you to feel that way? You know, and I was beating myself up about it. And then like one day, a couple months later, you know, it was just popped into my head, like why it was that way. And like, why it was that, and that it, don't stress about it. It's, you're fine, because you knew you weren't staying. You knew that. That's why you weren't upset. You already knew this was planned. You had already planned this. This was an exit strategy for you when your life got too off the rails. Like, and
let's let dive into that for a second, because that has been said many times on the show before.
Oh, really?
The exit strategy, the soul plan, the soul blueprint, and the exit strategy is something I've heard.
Oh, wow.
From other near-death experiencers, where like you have a soul plan, a blueprint, and throughout that, if you have, you live 80 years, let's say this blueprint's good for 80 years, you can get out at 25, you can get out at 62, you can get out at 57. There's moments in your life where you can literally exit the highway if you want to, exit strategy. And then that's when you have a near-death experience and you choose either to go and that's it, or you can come back. So I don't know if you haven't heard that before. That is common, believe it or not.
I haven't. I haven't really researched them, because it's been a lot. Like, it's stressful.
You have enough with your own, let alone start listening to other people.
Yeah, I mean, it is. I the belly button thing bothered me a lot, right? Like, why would I go back and through my belly button? But guess what? You know, like in my consciousness and classes I'm taking, turns out that's a thing apparently in like Buddhist tradition. I like
The silver
they just
cord.
enters in, like, yeah. And I was like, what?
Yeah.
Oh my God, I did not know that. Like, so that was weird, you know? I mean, so there was like weird things that I didn't know about that actually ended up being things that actually are talked about by many other people that do know about that stuff. And that was interesting to me, very much so.
When
But
you
yeah, that
when
keeps
you
happening. It's been happening. It keeps happening. I don't know if it'll stop or whatever, but I keep getting more information, like more understanding rather,
But it's
about a
being
lot of
dripped
things.
out to you. But it's being
Yeah.
dripped out to you,
It's
as
being, yeah.
opposed to if they all came in at once, you would you short circuit essentially.
Probably, right. Yeah, in this iterate, yeah, in my this body, yeah, absolutely too much. It would overload the system. Yeah.
So when you came out, when you came back from your near-death experience, and you start talking to your husband, you start talking to other people about this, how did the people around you deal with this new version, the non-drinker, figuring things out spiritually, all this new human being? How did that de how did they deal with you, and how did you deal with it?
I'm still dealing with it, because it's super drastic. I'm aware of that. Like most of the time, things like this would kind of change somebody, like in a way that is noticeable to people closest to them, right? But even they might know they think differently or something, but it's not that big of a deal. This is 100% different. It's almost like I've heard the concept of a walk-in, you know? Like I've almost feel like, but I know it's not that. But like it would be so close to like that level of change, like. I like everything about me, like just from keeping my word to, you know, being like having a goals, and it just, I had none of it before. Like I had earlier in life, but then I got, you know, in this bad way and like just stopped giving a crap. And now I all of a sudden I was just like, oh my God, I have to go back to school. I have to become a teacher. I teacher? What? I hated school. I was a bad student. I ditched all the time. Like, what do you mean? But yeah, no, I had to be a teacher all of a sudden and like do all this stuff. And then a job literally fell into my lap as a teacher. And like, I didn't even apply for it. Like they called me. I was like, when did I apply for this job? And they couldn't tell me when I did, 'cause I didn't. Like, it was crazy. I got that job. I worked there for years as my first teaching job. Like, and it was just weird. Like weird stuff started coming together, like, right after that. And my life just took a completely different turn, like totally. And now my friends and people, when they see me, they're like, literally, like my friend Maggie, she's like my best friend. She Every time I talk to her, she goes, I just can't believe this is you. And it's been years now, right? Like, and she still brings it up, like,
It's so
and
drastic.
yeah, I mean, I see it too. I like, but mine's different. Mine's a detachment from it that's so, like, completely settled, you know, like it's completely done that I can't even relate or resonate with the person I used to be at all. Like, it's hard for me to even put myself into my own shoes from back then. I don't want to. It was gross. And I'm like, it was pretty, you know, it was a bad time. Like, I'm glad I got out of that
But
way.
so it basically dying saved your life.
100%. Yep. Like full on. And my daughters, because I was not the best parent, you know, at all. And that's not the case now. Like my kids are happy and healthy and like taken care of, like properly. Like they're not, like I'm not just all about me anymore. Like, you know, I care. I'll put everybody else, I do everything for everybody now. Like I didn't do anything. I used to just be a selfish jerk, you know, like really.
Oh, I remember. Oh, I remember. I was in my teens and 20s too. So I
Like that,
remember.
right? Like that, you know, and like victim mentality, like my life sucks and there's nothing I can do about it. Like that
Poor
kind of,
me.
you
The
know,
poor
the
me
worst.
mentality. Right. It seems like, and don't take this the wrong way, but it almost seems like you're reluctant in this new version. In a way, you're like, I got a job. I guess I got to be a teacher now. I'm like, it's kind of like you're being guided, and you're just like, okay, I'll do this now. I can't drink anymore. I'm trying, but it doesn't work anymore. Like, it seems like there's a not a reluctancy, maybe that's not the right word, but you know what I mean, right? There's kind of like this weirdness, this weird energy about how you're moving forward now. You're happier, but you're
Right.
just like, what's going on?
Well, I want answers now. Like, so my scientific mind's
Right.
back, you know, and it's like, okay, well, I can't, like, what the hell, you know? So, now, but now I'm a different way. Like, before I would never talk. So, I've had paranormal experiences my whole life, despite the fact that I didn't believe in anything, like, despite that I was like, you know, nope, this doesn't exist. I had been tormented as a kid by, like, the house we lived in was so haunted and scary, but I would convince myself it was my imagination, right? Because that's what I was told. That's science. So I would deny all of these experiences I had all the time. And my family would also say, like, things like, don't act that way. If you're saying something, like telling somebody something was going to happen before it did, like, you'd get in trouble. I'd get in trouble for that kind of stuff, you know, like it's a bad thing. So, I just would be like, this is, you know, like, it's not real. It's not, I brainwashed myself to believe nothing existed, right? Like, because that was the safest option for me. And now I'm like, well, that's not true. So, and all the stuff they told me about tarot cards and things like that, like I was going to go to hell and, like,
oh, the
you know,
demons,
like
you're
doing
demons.
All, yeah, no, like I know, like I left. The one thing that I was very grateful for was all my Christian guilt of, like, my terror of, like, being judged and, like, burning in hell for eternity was completely, it just completely murdered that day. Like, thank God, like, it
wiped.
No way. Yeah. Like, it's not, that's not a thing. And, like, for me anyway, like, you believe what you want, but, like, I know for me, I'm good. So I was like, thank you. So I don't have any guilt about being someone that reads tarot cards. I don't have any guilt anymore about that, which is something that was ingrained into me, like, indoctrinated, like, it was wrong, it was bad, it was against God kind of stuff, right? So that helped a lot. That was a very big benefit for me. So yeah, so that's, and that, I'm much more myself now, like, who I am, weirdo, like, how weird and strange I am, and I'm okay with that. Like, before, I was hiding it all the time because it was against God, you know,
right?
Like,
According
that's
to according to what someone told you.
Yep.
How do you reconcile the scientific mind and now this new spiritual understanding that you have?
Right. Well, that's the fight I had in myself this whole time. And, like, that's why I was in such a bad way. Like, the denying, like, of myself and my true, like, authentic self was causing such inner turmoil, like, within me, that it was causing me to have addiction problems and depression and anxiety and things like that. And I didn't know that. Like, I didn't, that would never cross my mind to put those things together. So they were, I was like, have this, you know, this dichotomy of, like, this side, and they don't mix together. They can't. That's not true either. Like that, again, now it's like I'm integrating all of that together and doing research on this stuff, like, and in a scientific manner. So, like, I've been able to now take the both sides of that I love about myself, like the psychic stuff, and then this, you know, understanding now of what's real, really, on the other side, and be able to, like, marry those two with science, like, and it works, because now quantum physics and quantum mechanics, like, it's become talk. We can talk about it now, like, and it's being supported in actual mainstream science, which is amazing. I just got my research published, like, last week, for the, like, my actual research on trauma and DNA and psychic ability in people, like, how they possibly are connected. And that's, like, a big deal. Like, that would never have been published before.
Oh my,
like,
God, you would have been burned at the stake.
Yeah, I know. And I mean, and then, like, you know, that, and my research was based on a study that was done in 2021, a real peer reviewed at, you know, the Nordic Institute of Nordic Sciences did it on genetic component for psychic ability. And they found evidence that there is a genetic component. And, like, that's a big deal. So that's exciting. So, yeah, I'm okay with that now. Like, this is all becoming, now I can be myself wholly and not have to compartmentalize and, like, deny certain parts of myself. I'm just, and that's, so that's a freedom that I wouldn't have had otherwise. And I'm super grateful for that.
So you've at this point in your life now have gone all in. You understand what you've seen. You are now using your skill set that you'd built up over your life as a scientist and now applying it into the metaphysics world and the spiritual world and all this kind of stuff, and combining the two worlds. You are that, an agent of that, if you will, at this point.
Right. And 100%. And it's, I'm like thrilled. I, like, it's beyond exciting for me. Like, I never thought in my lifetime I'd see this happen, right? Like, you know, people being able to talk about it and taken seriously. And luckily, you know, I mean, it doesn't hurt that I have, like, previous research published from when I was just doing neural engineering has nothing to do with science, you know, spirituality. So like, that's helpful. But even if I didn't have that, like, it wouldn't matter, because now there's tons of up emerging researchers coming out and doing these studies and working on it, and it, people are listening. So that's great.
So let's dive into this other area of your life now, which is psychic abilities and the tarot cards and stuff, because I'm fascinated with the tarot cards. We'll talk about that in a minute.
Cool.
But these psychic abilities that you, when did they start to come out? How did they come out? How did you deal with it as well? Again, psychologically, to have these kind of abilities from a person who you were, and then also how that also all of a sudden you were like, when they came out, oh, I was living in a haunted house.
Right.
Kind of right. thing.
Right. So, like, again, growing up, haunted house, like, you know, and then everywhere I lived, basically haunted house. Pretty much I figured out it's me, not the houses. So like, that
right. sucks.
You know, that was recent. That was just last year that I came to that revelation. But, you know, my mom was hell, like, my mom had psychic premonitions all the time. And I would witness one that was so profound, like, in my life. I watched her have it. I saw what happened. It was my grandfather was dying, you know, at the house, and like, he had cancer, and she was making us food. She was making jello pudding. And she just kept saying to herself, I have to feed you kids. I have to feed you kids. Like, she was like almost like in a kind of a weird state, like a altered state. She was like zoning out, like during this bowl. And then she just went like, and dropped it. And it went, everyone, she goes, Papa died. Like, and she was like shaking and looking all weird. And I was like, what the hell, you know? And then like literally maybe 10, 15 seconds later, my uncle Harry walked out and he said, we just lost Papa. And like, I was there, I was 8 years old. I remember this, like it was yesterday. I have chills, like, actually. And she saw something. Like, I saw her have this reaction to nothing. You know what I mean? Like, I saw it, and it was so visceral, and it was terrifying to me as a kid. Right. But then, you know, I tried to talk to her about it later, it was like, I don't know what you're talking about. Right. Like that kind of stuff.
The programming is deep. The right. programming was deep.
Yeah. And then like the first time I saw someone's aura, like I was terrified. I did not know what the hell I was looking at. I didn't know why this person's head was glowing. Like, why is this, what's wrong with me? Like, and where, you know, like, where's the light source? What's going on? And I, you know, and then I'm thinking I'm going to go to hell because this is bad. Like, cause it, you know, so I had this problem because my grandparents told me this hell thing all the time. So I was like, I didn't even want to talk about it. So I didn't, right? Like, I never talked about it to anybody. I just kept it inside and totally just tried to snuff it out.
No wonder you were like, you almost self-destructed, because you were just holding down all of this knowing inside of you and denying so much that was inside of you that you just like, I got to drink. I got to do something.
Right. Like, yeah, when I was working at UCLA, okay, the lab there, my house was here in LA, was haunted again. And it was so bad that my babysitter quit, and like stuff like that, like other people, right, were telling me. And I was literally dealing with it and going, you guys are crazy. Like literally just telling them they're crazy, even though I'm experiencing the same stuff, because I refused. And at one point it got really bad, to the point where I actually had to, I had to move and admit that something very off was happening, something very not normal was happening. And my boss, I won't say his name just because, but like I could probably, but he asked me like what was going on. And I was like, well, you're going to think I'm crazy. My house is haunted. And he was like, I should talk to my wife. And I was like, okay, whatever. And I like just ignored it. And then his wife, he's like, she's a psychologist. And I was like, great, great, freaking great. Right. She actually came to my house with me and brought sage and like did a whole clearing thing with me. Like, she didn't judge me at all. She like came to help me. And I was like, what? So that was my first, that moment was my first glimpse of like, wait, you're the principal investigator, doctor, PhD in neuroscience, world famous, you know what I mean? Very well-known person. And you're married to a woman that does that. And you facilitated this for me. What the hell? You know what I mean? Like, that was really like, I was really confused by that, but it was a hopeful confusion. Right. You know, but it still, it was just too risky for me to like, be looked at like I was crazy in my field of, you know, work and stuff, because I could lose my, I was thinking I would lose my job. People wouldn't take me serious. My work would be discredited, whatever. So, you know, up until the day I died, like, I just kept denying it. And Yeah.
So, and once you came back though, how did the psychic abilities, were they just, now you knew what they were and you were like, okay, I can open up myself up to all of this?
No, I still didn't want to open up, but stuff kept happening really bad in my house. Like, it just kept getting worse and worse, and like weird stuff, like stuff flying, like literally coming off the walls and like hitting people in the head. Like, my friend Maggie got attacked by a spatula. Like, just crazy stuff that was happening. And my mother-in-law, moment, you know, she's, we call, I still call her that, but she, you know, we're not related anymore, but she is from Trinidad. And so they practice like voodoo over there. And she says to me, girl, you know why they're doing this, right? Because you refuse to acknowledge it. You refuse. And so they're trying to get your attention. You're like a beacon. They come and they're like, oh, she can help. She can see us. And then you're ignoring them and they're pissed. And I'm like, sorry, like, you're trying to tell me that all I have to do is just acknowledge it and they'll stop this nonsense. And she's like, yeah. Did I listen? Nope, sure didn't. Wait another year with crazy stuff happening in my house. And then finally, the end of that year, I was like, fine. All right, guys, fine. And then it just stopped like that. And I was like, are you joking? Is this serious? This is not. I was so mad that I, like, it was that easy. Like, what?
All these decades, really?
Right. And then the other thing too was interesting is, like, okay, so I've been reading tarot cards since I was 12, right? So anyone that reads tarot cards since they're 12 should have them memorized by now, right? Okay, yeah, but I don't. If you asked me what this card meant, I would be able to tell you, right? And I was really irritated with myself by this. So I was like, I can memorize lots of things. Why can't I memorize these cards? Like, why can't I get it? And then I started reading cards online again on like a Facebook group, and I started recording it, and I watched the recordings, and I was like, oh my God, what am I doing? What is happening in this reading? Because I think I'm sitting there reading cards, but that's not what the camera shows. Camera shows me not even looking at cards and like looking at the ceiling and asking questions to something that I don't see, and I don't remember any of it. So I really quickly realized that I'm channeling. Holy shit. I'm channeling. This is not me. That's why I don't remember what I say. That's why I don't remember what the cards mean. It's because it's not even me reading it. Like, and it was really weird. It's very disturbing to see that. So I went to USC to get a psych evaluation done because I wanted to make sure that I wasn't schizophrenic, that I wasn't having psychosis, that I wasn't, you
You're
know,
not.
mentally
You are
ill.
not. Technically, you are nuts.
Yeah. I'm nuts, but I'm not clinically
Not clinically nuts. You're just
right.
normally organically nuts, like I am. Like,
Like,
we all have our
yeah.
special kind of
And
nuts.
I went for 2 weeks, this long process. 2 weeks testing, assessed, reassessed, interviewed, you know, and there was a whole panel of doctors like and clinicians there. And they gave me my report and it was no. You just have some complex trauma, but you don't have any mental illness or anything like that. So that was it. And I was like, okay, so that's ruled out. So, you know, I've done the scientific method on myself. Like, I've made sure that I'm not just mistaking something for something else, right? You know, now, like, I can't tell you where it comes from. I can't tell you, like, you know, why me, but why I have it. And, you know, my like brother doesn't or something, right? But it is what it is. So I'm just at this point kind of relinquishing that need to know the why and just going with the it is. So let's just work with it now.
So let's dive into these tarot cards because I'm fascinated with tarot cards. I know nothing of them. I've had a tarot card reading once or twice in my life. I think they're really fun. But can you explain? I always found that interesting because just like anyone could read a tarot card. It's kind of like you have a deck, you shuffle it, and whatever cards come out, it's the universe kind of guiding the cards to tell you your future. But you need to have someone who understands what the cards mean to tell you what's going on, kind of.
I mean, like anyone can read tarot. They come with a booklet, tells you, even they even have cards that have like the meanings printed on the face, for people. But that's like when I read tarot, that's not how I'm not looking at the books right anymore. But and you can do that. So they're amazing. Whoever, we don't know exactly who made them, first, but whoever made them was so smart, like so beyond way before their time, because they managed to make these 78 cards that will encompass any possible human experience that can possibly happen within someone's lifetime. Like the fool's journey, like it's a storyline, you know, it starts with the fool And it goes through this, you know, like the growth and the trials and tribulations of a person on their path to individuation, right? Like that's basically what it is. And it's like this person, you know, going through the ups and downs, love and hate and like fights and all this, but the way that they're combined with each other is like, yeah, it's really, it's crazy. Like it, every time I read people cards and they, I always get feedback. People will be like, oh my gosh, you read my cards. Do you remember? I'm like, no, I don't. Sorry. I do not remember. But, that I'll take your word for it. And they'll tell me, you said this was going to happen, whatever. And it did. And I'm like, cool. Like, great. I'm glad, I guess. Right. But I like, don't know. I just don't know how they work. Like it's fascinating to me because it's, they're accurate so often. I mean, really, with details that you can't know, like stuff, right? Like it's just, there's no way I can know it. But they work and you could read them, you know, you just, yours would be a little bit more in the beginning, like limited to just what the cards mean on paper. But there's a lot of symbolism in there too. So like all of the cards have symbols and the different colors that are represented all mean something too, to the psyche. Cause you know, like Carl Jung said that we, our soul speaks in symbols. Like that's our, so symbolism is huge. And that's what kind of triggers. It's like a lot. Like, so when I use cards, it's not really me using the cards. It's that I'm using them as a key to open the door, like, for, I guess,
information to come in.
So I'm not really, I use them, but they're not the end all be all when I do readings. That makes sense. Like
what, Anna, what fascinates me about you is that you're a scientist who reads tarot cards.
Like I'm not a scientist anymore.
But you have a scientific mind. You have
I'm a teacher.
Yeah. But you know what I mean. You were a scientist. You're going through
your PhD. College psychology now and world religion. Yeah. And you know, at college here in Los Angeles, like I am a college teacher and I am a researcher. So I am researching in my program. And yeah, right. I have that analytical mind. I do. And anytime I hear people tell my stories, I take it very skeptically at first, right? I do. Even I'm still skeptic. I'm absolutely still skeptic, even after all this stuff.
But you're not a skeptic about what you experienced.
No.
Right.
No, I can't. I would love to try. I tried. It didn't work out.
There seems to be like there's been a battle inside of you.
Yes.
Constantly. Mm-hmm. Since before, during, and after your near-death experience.
I'm stubborn, you know? I'm a very stubborn person, and, like, it's really hard. It's because it's, look, it's like, I don't ever want to, I am a very humble, like, I don't like people that are, like, very gregarious and ostentatious, and, like, you know, I don't, like, I think that's a very good characteristic to have, so I don't like to come across that, like, I don't want to come across as being, like, oh, I'm so cool or special, ever, so it's hard for me to, like, you know, it's hard for me to say this happened sometimes because it's like people tend to think it's really interesting. Right. And so then I automatically get scared that I'm coming across as like, you know, like, as like,
right. You don't want to be. Yeah. You don't.
It's
be
really hard for me. It's like a weird thing. I don't like I'm to come across as inauthentic or like, you know, trying to get attention. Right. Because that's not it. Like this, I don't care if anyone believes me or not, like about this, I could care less. I know what I experienced and that's all that matters. Like, literally. And it's just, to me, it's crazy that I still though argue with myself about it.
Let me ask you this though. So you are obviously publicly out. You've stepped out of this NDE spiritual closet, if you will.
Yep.
How has this affected like your job? I mean, I imagine students look you up.
Oh yeah. Unfortunately. So I don't teach high school anymore. I'm good. I would never have been able to talk about this stuff when I was a high school teacher at all. As a high school biology teacher, that was my job. No way. Parents would have had an absolute nipping fit and had me fired. So I couldn't even talk about any of that stuff. Like if students asked me questions, I never could answer anything because it's just, I couldn't, you know, I couldn't risk it. Mm-hmm. And it's not my place to talk about that stuff in class anyway. That's not teacher's job. You're supposed to teach.
Of course.
Okay. College though, is different because they're adults. So I don't have to worry about parents, you know, coming at me. They try, but it doesn't work. And my students are great. You know, I don't talk about my stuff in my classes ever, but I do have students that find me online and like TikTok and stuff. And I'm just like, hi, well, welcome, you know, but I'm still your teacher at school. So like, watch yourself, like watch your comments. I'm still grading your papers. But, you know, like most of my students are my friends after they're out of my classes. Like most of them are, you know, people that come to me, ask me for advice later. You know, and they, I've had, yeah, like students kind of, you know, keep in contact with me and tell me how they're doing and stuff like that. So
do you find in your experience being a teacher, that this new generation is so much more open-minded about things like this, as opposed to our generation, or God forbid your parents' generation or your grandparents' generation? Do you see like a significant change in this new crop of souls, if you will, coming up?
I see a lot of looking for meaning, because like our generation, like I'm, you know, 44. So my generation was 90, you know, 80s, 90s. We were getting jobs already. Like I was working at 14. I was out of my house way before 18. I was already an adult by the time I was like teenager. So I didn't have time to think about this kind of stuff really. You know, I had other things to worry about. Like these kids, they have more of that afforded to them, and they are looking for meaning anywhere they can find it. Definitely. And that's one of those things too, that's, it was hard for me, because like some of them, I see them, you know, kind of like looking at some stuff that might not be so great for them, right? You know, as an option. And it's like, I couldn't say anything. So it was really hard for me to be a teacher at high school level, because I couldn't help. I just couldn't. So I had to stop because it was painful to, you know, see like, oh no, that's not right. I couldn't even talk about it. Like, you know, so right.
But college
they, and they'd
different.
Ask me, they'd come and ask me like stuff. Like they knew I would, they knew I knew the answer, but I couldn't tell them, like, you know. So I mean, I had kids that would wait till they're 18. I'm 18 now. Can we be friends online? Like that all the time. Like students all the time. You know, and I'd be like, fine, okay, you're over 18, you're not in my class anymore. Fine, you can now, I'll let you friend me on whatever, but only because you're 8. You know what I mean? Like,
sure, that, I get you.
Yeah. And I'm they're definitely more open to it, and they are not, they don't ridicule. There's no like bullying's not like the same it was.
Oh God, we were, it was brutal. It was brutal when we were growing
up. Yeah, it was.
Oh my God.
Freshman Friday and stuff like that. I mean, come on. Yeah.
Brutal. Oh my God. Physical, emotional.
It was
mental, psychological. Oh God.
Yes. It was a scarring for life. Yes. Yes.
But you know what? It made us a bit stronger. That's why we're more resilient than we are, than many of the newer generation might be sometimes.
It's true. Very true. Yes. We have thicker skin. Yes.
Oh, without, yeah. So Gen X is just like, it doesn't bother me. Whatever.
Yeah. Like whatever. We'll get through it. We were like left at home alone to fend for ourselves anyways.
with three channels of television. And,
oh my God. I know. But great music on the radio. At least, you know, hey, at least there was that.
Fantastic music. Fantastic music.
The best.
And I'm going to ask you a few questions, ask all my guests. Okay. How do you define a fulfilling life?
So for me, that's a big one now is, I've done a lot of things with my life that don't match each other. Like, you know, different jobs that I've had because I wanted to. And that, like for me, continuing on that path of like, once I get my interest spark, that I go for it and I find a way to get into that thing and for however long that needs to happen. Because at the end of the day, I don't want to be old and sitting there wishing I'd done things with my life and I can't do them now. So like none of that, like I am all about getting experiences in now and like, not waiting for later. But then the big one on top of that is to make sure that I'm giving back to other people. So like, I help people with trauma, right? Like I help people like process trauma because I had a really traumatic bringing up and like, I'm maybe a little more resilient than some other people might be. So I'm going to help because that's my job, because that's why I was put through that stuff. Like if you just go through stuff in life and then you're just like, and when it's over, you're like, whatever. You know, and you just get to go about your business. Well, happy for you. But like, that is not my path. Like I have got to be there to help facilitate for other people in order for me to have what I consider to be a fulfilling life.
If you can go back in time and talk to that little girl, what advice would you give her?
You were right. Keep it up.
Great advice.
Yeah.
How do you define source or God?
It's us. It's us. Like, we are it. It is us. Like, and it's the. It's like we're here experiencing humanity and human emotions as this fragmented, one of 8 billion fragments of source. You know, and it's like each individual drop of water, you know, but like all those drops of water together form that sea of consciousness and understanding, and like that's what we are. That's how I like to describe it.
And what is the ultimate purpose of life?
That one I don't know. Like I don't know. I think it's just to, I mean, gosh, to damn it. I do. Maybe I just heard something. Okay. So, to learn to love yourself despite your flaws, despite all your shortcomings, and to learn to like be nice and kind to the people around you despite their shortcomings and their flaws. That's what it's about.
And where can people find out more about you and the work that you're doing?
So I have my research gate page up with my research. Just, you know, it's Anna Stone, research gate. And then the artsofthought.com is where my recent, just published last week, article is on trauma, DNA, and psychic ability. Yeah, that's artsofthought.com. And then I have my website, A Stone Tarot, and for tarot readings. I also do free tarot card readings on YouTube. And I have a podcast now, a video podcast about witchcraft. So I'm like all out there now. I'm completely out of the broom closet, right? Witchcraft, esoterica, and psychic abilities every Thursday at 3 p.m. Pacific and Friday at 7 p.m. Pacific on my channel, which is A Stone Tarot and Magic. And we do free readings like on the channel for people that if you don't, you can't afford that, I get it. And so we offer them for free on the lives. And you can ask any questions that you have about any of that stuff, psychic abilities, witchcraft, anything that you're curious about, everything, everybody's welcome to come and check it out and like get some information, some accurate information, not, you know, TikTok misinformation. So, you know, like actually academic backed stuff. So yeah, that's where you can find me.
And do you have any parting messages for the audience?
Yeah, like you guys just be nice to each other and to yourself. Like seriously, that's what it's all about. And like, we're not different, literally. We're not different at all. We are different on the outside to your eye, but not on the inside. Everybody's exactly the same. We all come from the same place. We're all going back to the same place. So y'all need to get it. Stop being all twisted about your differences and like start looking at the similarities instead, because it's kind of ridiculous.
Anna, it has been such a pleasure talking to you. Thank you so much for sharing your journey. That it has been, it's been an adventure talking to you today, and it's been a long journey from when you were young to where you are now. I appreciate your bravery and for everything you're doing, my dear. I appreciate it.
Thank you so much. Appreciate you having me.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.